All right, we're going to go back to the record.
May I make a brief request regarding your decisions? I would like you to make specific findings, not only about the mitigation issue and about whether or not you committed offenses, but also whether or not this issue is permitted to be modified, and also on the point of inconsistent discipline. I think that's incumbent upon you by rulings on those separate issues.
Submitted. Thank you.
Thank you.
At this point, we're going to draw the hearing process for the appeal process to a close and continue the deliberation. This will mark an end to any input by council or witnesses. So we won't have any attempt to take these issues on the notice of dismissal point by point. If you could look at this, what Mr. Moore said in terms of order of these things will actually make sense to me. So if we could just number down 26.2.3, the first one is number one, and then skip over number three and order that number two. So just go to the 1, 3, 2, 4. Does that make sense to you?
Mm-hmm.
One, three, two, four. And just in the order to discuss them.
Where do we skip the number of 2 to 3?
Yeah, 1, 3, 2, 4.
Yeah, I'll go to all of them and start trying to make sure that it doesn't all work.
Mr. Chair, Turtle Paper requests that you please speak up so I can get it on the recording.
You may make that request, whether I can comply with conjecture. All right, so we'll take these orders. We'll try and discuss them. That was suggested, and then we know from experience to try and read the findings of that into the record. And if we go along, I don't want to hear any mitigating facts that might come up in our thoughts. But I think once we get to the final determination of whether or not we go to recommend a hold of dismissal, that's where we'll address the mitigation of in more general fashion. So, that said, let's take as number one point of discussion 26.2.33 intention duties. And at this point, I'll just invite anybody to step forward first and opine on what they glean from this hearing.
Should we make the motion first and then we can get to the discussion? Should we discuss the main motion?
If you have a motion to make, I'm willing to hear it.
I'm just trying to get to some of it in an orderly fashion. So,
I'm fine. If you have a motion to make, that's fine.
Instead,
I think you've done it both ways. If somebody typically, we just discussed them first, and if somebody feels that we feel that we're getting all out there, we want to get out.
Let's discuss it.
That's fine. Why don't you have something you want to say on that?
Is there a thing, Sarah, if we do some discussing? Okay, this first one, 26.2.3. Both Mr. Lynch and Deputy Malcolm have talked about the issue of precedent charges or no. To me, that's paramount in this part where she wrote no, or she wrote yes, and she said no, I don't want precedent charges at all. That is, to me, that's inattention. And when I asked him, did he read the report, he said yes, and I said something about how did you read. He told me yes, he scanned it. To me, that's an intention. I think you should read it closely.
I would like a specific order.
And I agree with that because also in later on, I think you did say that if you had to do it again, you would be able to.
He did. Are we going to have a chance to make any general comments on this? I just don't ask him. If the answer is no, it's okay.
Well, I think not.
Okay, that's fine.
That's fine.
I made Jim a little wrong. Okay.
Yeah,
we'll see. No, that's fine. All right, we're on this. I'm sorry. I apologize.
Anybody want to weigh in differently on number one there? Or if somebody wasn't afraid to make a motion, that would be fine.
The, to me, number one, as with exhibits three and four, and the Mr. Baughman's testimony, I think that that's kind of obvious. So I would make a motion that we, and I hope you use the right word, sustain the, this particular finding.
Of 26.2.
26.2.33.
And I said, are we going to?
Yes,
should I second it?
Yes, you should.
I mean, I want to. I will second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion on that motion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Record should note that that was passed unanimously. Second point of discussion, I'm going to move down to where it says RE.26.2.401, negligence associated with safety of persons or property.
Now, this, to me, I don't understand. I don't know what the person's property was neglected. Because I just don't, I mean, because there wasn't any property. And if this has to do with, no, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. Never mind. That's all I got to say. So.
Well, no, that's exactly what we discussed. We've heard a lot over several days here. I just want to let our minds gel.
Which one are we on?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm on the wrong one.
26.2.401.
Yes, and you're talking about personal property, and I think we are.
We're on number two.
We're on number two.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
In my amended word.
That's correct.
Okay. To me, this refers or could be construed to cover the David system violation that was discussed. We phoned in for information on dispatchers. Also, so again, it covered the attentiveness issue of new job duties and maybe not collecting evidence that might have been available at the time. The rest of the comment on that.
In covering what he covered, I thought he covered everything that he could. When he was doing his incident report, I just think he missed reading the lady's statement. And that's about, he missed reading the lady's statement. But I can't see anything else in that. In my mind, he misread the lady's statement, but in my mind, the whole system screwed up in the first place because there was no follow-up. I mean, everybody screwed up.
Is this 26.2.133? Oh, man. Yeah, that one.
Exhibits 3 and 4, and it speaks to his, in my mind, to the disciplinary record. The problem that I have, and I know some of the discipline was in the past, but the problem that I have is that I want an employee that will be consistent in their duties. Yes, we are all human, and yes, this is not a perfect system. I don't think progressive discipline, there is any system that is perfect. And having been a supervisor of 106 employees, and having done some of this, people make mistakes. I know that. But I also look for people that will correct their mistakes, not make them again, and be consistent in their duties, people that I can count on. And so this one bothers me with other things that you said, I heard you, but also with some of the disciplinary history that I saw.
In fact, and I think too that the sheriff commented the proof of those violations and to me, I think. But and to accept the responsibility, you know, is not
Then isn't this the one that Mr. Fitch pointed out? I think in the book that is, you can do just a demotion with that.
Correct.
It's not a criminal offense.
Right. So that confuses me a little bit. Some of the things we discussed are not going to.
But we're not talking about punishment right now.
It doesn't have to.
So forget that.
Findings of fact in the record.
Okay.
You spoke, of taking the responsibility for your actions. And I do think that the testimony convinced me in this case that that was not done in an acceptable fashion. Does speak to the ability of an employee to be rehabilitated and kept in a job.
Okay.
So that didn't sit well with me, sort of reaffirmed my confidence in the dismissal. Mm-hmm. But that's just a discussion point at this point.
On this one, I guess, since it was the Davis system and it did validate whatever rules there are against the Davis system. In that sense only.
It's David's.
Wouldn't the negligence also be referenced in some of those other exhibits, like the 1 and 2 and in fact, all of the exhibits that were looked at, so that's why I'm concerned with FOIA.
I want to get everybody's input in this, that's what I'm going to flesh that out. Go ahead.
There are so many instances where it's a lack of adhering to the standards of the sheriff's department. And I guess I kind of lump all those into that designation of negligence. And then when I think the title of it is so broad, but the car deal, there are just so many things that would be proof of negligence.
And some of these may fit in more than one category.
Yeah.
So I think. The more specific one is number 4, the last one.
We're at number 2 right now.
Correct.
Let's talk about number 2. Let's talk about number 2, because looking at that, I'm also thinking supervisory instructions. And that included when to work and when not to work, being suspended from work, misunderstandings, all of that issue.
No, see, that to me,
Working, I mean, working in the wrong time to me is very simple. Half the people in the world don't understand what a patriot is. I mean, that's just, I mean, and so I don't think that was well explained in that letter, and it just makes no sense to me. I mean, I said it last time, I'll say it again. I don't understand how you can punish somebody for what you did on that. It just makes no sense. Half the people in the world do not understand patriots. So you have to be specific about what you're saying in this letter. It was not specific. So I can understand how you made that mistake. But I can't understand how you just, sorry.
You can't understand what?
I got just a little.
Well, see, to me, that goes back to one's responsibility on the job. They know that they're paid for it. Is it 2 week paid?
You have to people in the world. You can have
yeah, they didn't get that paid.
The only time you understand pay periods is if you're a supervisor and if you have to get
and you have to do the billing.
You have to do put the time in.
But I think
other than that, nobody, and I work all these years, half of them don't understand pay periods because they don't coincide with regular dates.
The paper in the letter itself had specific
and
dates.
Specific dates did not have
more than 7 days.
But I think there are more things in today's than just that suspended pay period.
Oh, yeah. No, there is. That was just one example
that I was saying. But I know that step being brought up. Yeah, okay. Because then I'm going out.
I was looking at all the different parts of it and trying to put examples with the different parts. So, yes, there's more than just that with this.
Well, I think we're going to have a chance to flesh out our findings in these other areas.
Okay.
Yeah, this one is not listed here. It says something about in the rule that was put the subject to an information in this section. Any further discussion on this motion on the agenda? All right, all those in favor of the motion that we uphold 26.2.4 lines of violation, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign.
No.
Motion carries. Which is number two, number four. 26.2.113. 133. That's our what we're discussing. 26.2.133. Failure to maintain necessary skills. This was interesting to me, because it does say in there that several things happen. One, your testimony that recommends are aware. We also read in there that this violation occurs that the department shall provide additional training. So I just thought that was interesting. Maybe the time frame was not exactly in there. But as anything, it says exactly what happened.
And this says after counseling and instruction, and he testified he received counseling and instruction. People have to make the EAP, and EAP should have, or if they did, I don't know whether they did or not, recommend staff training after counseling.
Why did Mr. Bush say after each one of these instances that occurred, what he's written up with the counseling or whatever, did you just see the counseling or had any further instruction on how better to handle that? And invariably, the answer was no.
Yeah. I mean, he did go to that EAP, but then he recognized he had a problem. His responsibility again is that. And after he got the EAP, wasn't it brought out that he received in another reprimand in 2015 that had been gone in 2014. Wondered, okay. So.
Where was counseling?
At the employee assistance program, the county employee assistance program.
I know that, but I mean, all of the other, I'm sorry, where was the failure to maintain necessary skills?
Well, as evidenced by the counseling that we received, one by one, the EAP is not additional training, maybe that's a difference.
No.
That's different. So where's the counseling here?
Well, you receive the EAP, they have 4 or 5, didn't you say that 4 or 5 sessions with the counselor?
No, that was EAP.
Well, that's what I'm saying, what are you asking?
I'm asking, where was the counseling, where was the failure, the ability to have the counseling? What counseling did he receive, that's my question, excluding EAP?
EAP is at the end.
What counseling did he receive? I don't see anywhere that there was counseling in his history. Nobody recommended counseling in his history. Did I miss that?
He didn't think he did, because I feel the same way, that he didn't receive any, and they didn't suggest any until the only thing that they suggested was mandatory EAP.
Right. And that, there was no counseling after reprimand, after all of those reprimands, there was no counseling. And
our training.
If we're thinking of counseling in the true sense of the word, the meaning of the word counseling, I don't see it either. EAP was at the end, but if you're thinking of counseling as the sheriff's department giving him different skills, different training, he did have that because he went to, for example, diversity training. But if you're thinking of counseling as a different meaning, then no, he didn't.
I'm talking about counseling related to his letters of reprimand. There was no counseling related to his letters of reprimand.
However, in those letters of reprimand, it states that there is any problem or condition that is troubling you that we are unaware of. Please advise so that this office will have the opportunity to assist you in correcting this problem.
But it did not say, because of this problem, we would like for you to attend ABC conference.
Yeah, they can recommend it. Training mandatory.
They mention the progressive discipline.
Yes.
So then where is the individual's responsibility to say, okay, then perhaps I do need to do something. Just as when I asked him about filing a grievance or whatever, or an appeal, if he did not agree with what was being said, and none was ever filed.
And I have a question. It says repeated failure to maintain moral law. Doesn't the sheriff's department, don't they have a training division? Don't they have some responsibility in this 26.24133? Skills, knowledge, and abilities. I know there's a lot of training goes on in this county.
I don't know the
sheriff's department.
Right, and I don't see how you can say that it was failure to maintain necessary skills when he was getting above average evaluation year after year after year. Now, there's something wrong with that.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, they don't fit together.
But doesn't counseling also include advice or help from your peers? And look at Exhibit 7 when he had a confrontation with the other deputies.
Exhibit 7 to me just says that he got punished for disagreeing with his supervisor. That's what it says to me.
Right.
But okay. Now, you know, and I don't know, it's just interesting to me. You have a different opinion, you go and do what the supervisor says, and then you get punished. I don't understand that. I'm sorry.
Let me ask you this also. You know, it's been said that he was a field training officer and some of the skills there. So if he were training others, then aren't we to assume that he knew what the rules and regulations and standards are and therefore should uphold those?
I would think that's correct. He ought to be better at it than most of the others.
So. So we're 26.24133 M2U00743?
Mm-hmm.
So I move that we uphold that. Sustaining whatever the correct amount is.
I think it's okay to disagree with your supervisor. I don't have a problem with that. But you also have to, I'm sorry.
I'm going to say.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, second.
Any further?
Repeat the motion, because I obviously was thinking.
That we sustain the 26.2.133. We uphold what is.
And we have a second on that.
Okay.
So we'll discuss it. Further discussion on that? We can come back on to talk about that in our final motions. We need further discussion on that motion. All in favor of the motion, say aye.
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 Those like sign.
No, I mean aye. Opposed.
Close enough, yeah.
Sal is opposed.
I oppose.
Well, the chair finds that that motion passes 3-2.
I'm sorry, who was the other objection? Thank you.
All right, we'll go to the last one listed here is 26.2.96, processing property and evidence. Violation subject up to dismissal. And this has a lot of description of this section on page 2 of the final termination, so I'll throw it over to discussion.
I don't know what evidence he didn't turn in.
Well, the discussion was along the lines of not having collected the evidence in order to turn it in, which
I think
the mitigating factor at this point was that she was in a hurry, didn't want to take her cell phone, and I don't know what I meant for that, but a lot of issues involved.
But all of this information and everything came after the fact, 1 year later. After everybody else had failed, I mean, everybody in the procedure, the admitted procedure, had failed to do what they were supposed to do. And now, a year later, we say that he didn't get the proper information. And you've got, I mean, somebody else brought it to the attention of your department. I mean, to me, this is just, I think he got what he could get at the time. That's my, in my opinion, I think he got what he could get at the time. We've already admitted that he didn't read properly or didn't properly read the person's testimony. But I don't know how you can read all this other stuff into that incident and having it and it being collected at that particular time. So I don't see what evidence he left out there. I'm sorry. But it seems to me that for a year nobody else saw it either. So
the sheriff say that he considered all past reprimands when he deliberates. This letter only describing to November 2014. It's not saying well, and also. Like it wasn't considered, or was it?
I was going to use that same one for the opposite thing and say, yes, he is saying it's not the first instance. And I know that's what I'm saying is the fact that you were saying they only did two. And I was saying I was about to use the same thing, but to use it the other way, saying it was not the first instance. And so it was the progressive discipline and the fact that, again, gave him the opportunity on January 4th, I think it was, to come in and talk to him, and it was no ownership of anything, whereas it was with that cop case that was being used. And the fact that, you know, lack of judgment and continued failure to comply with the proper standards and directives.
It was lack of judgment, and I think the fault, and this is really not a fault, but he was compassionate when he didn't take her cell phone.
Yeah.
he needed it.
And I hate to say that's a fault, because I was glad to see that.
I think every deputy has rules and regulations to follow, and all these sheriff's directives and all that. But they've got to have a little bit of common sense on the road, or they could get in an incident where they get killed or get someone else killed. So they have to kind of evaluate each situation and put their own spin on it in accordance with the directives from the sheriff's department.
I think the situation was hurried, and he didn't ask the correct questions. Maybe if it wouldn't have been so hurried, he would have asked. But Brenda, you are correct. There are rules and regulations that must be followed.
And we're second guessing what person did. Hold up. 1 year later. And to me, that is very, to me, it's very crucial, because the fact that he didn't collect the cell phone, the fact that he misinterpreted the person's handwritten testimony, and the fact that it did not get caught like it is supposed to have when it is reviewed, all tells me that there's more than just him messing up, but the whole system messed up. And didn't nobody notice it until a year later when somebody called in and inquired.
The system.
And then there was a rush to find somebody to hang out. And this guy called in. I'm sorry.
I don't know if the whole system is messed up, but I do agree with you.
I didn't say messed up. I said on this particular case,
yeah,
the whole system.
Okay, fair enough.
Did what they weren't, didn't do what they were supposed to do. And this guy is suffering for it.
But if it had been his only misstep, he would not have been suffering from it.
In reviewing the testimony of the sheriff on this, and in terms of, he brought in, I guess this would be a counselor, and he said, what's going on here? Your evaluations have tanked here a little bit in several categories. And he pointed out lack of judgment in some other instances, one being the dating system. Another was a rather briefly mentioned involvement with an alligator, which was, you know, we talked about that for a while in the addressing, but there were definitely other areas where his judgment or decision making might have been questioned, and that was reflected in his evaluations.
We are supposed to decide on substantive evidence, not compassion. We're supposed to go back to facts.
That's what we're here for, fact finding of facts.
Correct.
So what is our opinion on whether or not this 6.2.96 was held up by testimony?
I would move that we, whatever the word for it is, do not uphold, we do not sustain 26.2-96.
Well, before we get off the motion, you need a second. If I don't hear a second, it's going to dock or lack of a second. Motion has died, will I have a second? Do we hear an alternative motion?
I move that we sustain to 6.2.96.
I second it.
Open for discussion, further discussion.
I don't really have any others other than dates of other failure to follow procedures.
Six. Answer by saying aye.
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 Pose like sign.
Pose.
Noted. Motion carries. Ready to vote. That gets us through that portion. Now, let's talk about propriety of penalty. And thus, we should discuss any additional thoughts on mitigating factors, comparative punishment for other similar offenses, and subject to that nature, so I'll have a discussion regarding propriety of penalty.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
In my opinion, in my voting, I agree with 26.2.33, and I think that the penalty should have been in line with the one-day suspension or something other than termination. I think that the penalty is too harsh. I think that we are failing to, I mean, I think that I know that Mr. Baughman made a mistake. There's no denying that. I recognize that. But I think that not only did he, but I see nothing else here that points out the other mistakes that were made in addition to his. So I just think that the penalty is way out of line. And I think it is not in line with his evaluations and his performances. And so that's it.
I'd like for all of us to weigh in a little bit on this before we get to the point of making a motion.
I voted that I only agree with 26-2-33. So
that's very consistent. I have some problems with it too. In all of these hearings that we've had over the past years, penalty book on an employee is designed to correct behavior and to improve their performance if possible. I'm not sure that that happened in this case, but it's not my job to, again, to substitute my action. For what the sheriff did, what we're here to talk about is whether or not he was within his guidelines with his thought process. Was he then justified in doing what he did?
Who he did? He did the sheriff?
He did the sheriff.
He did the sheriff? Yeah.
Yes. I think I agree with EZ that there's something other than termination, and I would like to see. If we do go that way and make that recommendation, that we include training, some whatever type of training that they think that's best for him. We can't dictate to them what training, but whatever they think is best.
As it relates to inconsistencies, Mr. Chairman and the Chair, in my opinion, I think there are all kind of inconsistencies. I think they were very well pointed out by the defense attorney, in my mind. And that's why I'm taking a position
when I know that people can make mistakes, and I've heard many times they said that, you know, we're not pro-box, and that's true, and they all can make mistakes. But I think one of the things that I way heavily is the fact that the one difference is that when you go and you meet with the sheriff, you take full responsibility. But when you continue on, then it does taint that whole department. So when are you going to be able to say, you know, these are the rules, these are the procedures, everybody else has to follow them. But, you know, here you've got one who has how many violations just in a matter of 8 years, maybe, you know, I've had fewer years than that, actually. And so that's why I would be supporting or upholding the decision.
Following up on that comment, part of it does bother me is the inability to take ownership. I don't know particularly here, but I some respects, Mr. Baughman forced his hand on that. And I feel like that the sheriff, while I may not agree completely with doing this, I think he was within, certainly within his authority to do that. So I feel all that.
He's got the money here. He run it paramilitaries, like he's the colonel, the general, or whatever the rank is.
I was surprised that term did not get used.
Which amazes me, I don't know how one person.
It's kind of cheese, so what's about a cheese?
I don't know how one person can possibly make decisions on a firing board.
Well, he's got a chief that, and I'm sure others, because I remember hearing him mention something about other personnel.
And just looking back on April 3rd, the April 3rd, 2014, the letter from the sheriff listed 8 times of subject to disciplinary action. And then on the 20th, there's more violations. And with the one on September 7th being the most egregious.
But nothing was ever, well, all of those disciplinary actions, nothing was ever offered up. Nothing was ever offered up on behalf of Mr. Baughman. Nothing. But it's just discipline and on the way and more beautiful evaluations. Discipline, more and more beautiful evaluations. I mean, the man can't be even so bad.
But what do you think? Corrective disciplines would have worked and would have changed the behavior?
Corrected?
Yeah, because that's what all the reprimands in one sense.
There was no correctness to it. It was just reprimands.
It got too exhausted.
I mean, it was
consistent.
Somewhere during that time, somebody, his supervisor, should have recognized that he's gotten these other reprimands, and is he, or has he completely changed the way he is working according to those reprimands? Has he corrected all those reprimands? And if so, if you give him this,
I agree with that, but you can't put all of the onus on Bush County Sheriffs. Yes, they had a part of it, but so did Mr. Ronald. I was sitting listening to all this.
You didn't let me finish.
And, I'm sorry. Go ahead, you finish. This has been going around in my head, and I've been trying to make a decision. Go ahead.
I forgot what I was going to say. Go ahead.
Well, I'm not going to do this transcript.
I forgot what I was going to say. No, I didn't. Go ahead.
You stay in the middle, honey.
What I have been trying to make a decision, and this has been so hard because this man has been sitting there for 3 days, and it has got to be so hard. I know it's hard on us, but it has got to be hard on him. And I see in him, with things that he has done, a lot of compassion and wanting to help the public. I want a police officer that has that. But I also want somebody that will follow the rules and knows the rules and that will follow the rules. So I've been going back and forth with this, back and forth with this. I feel like I know this man. And I want to say for the record, I think he's a good person and I like him. But I have to separate that and go back to the facts. The facts that are all in here. And to me, when you go back to the substantive evidence, I am going to uphold what the sheriff says and go for the dismissal.
Do you have to place that in the motion?
Joey's already made it.
Well, I think Brenda has something to say if she remembered what she was going to say.
I can't remember.
Joey, did you make a motion?
So much has been said. I think I did say I would uphold the sheriff's decision. But if not,
she
didn't
say
it.
Well, we have a motion on the table to before we vote on this, I'd like to say thanks to the board too. This is not easy. This is the hardest part here where we're kind of put our heart out on the table. And it's hard to get through that part of the process and then come back to the nuts and bolts for what we're here for. So I appreciate everybody's compassion and attention and cognitive abilities throughout the past few days.
It's hard not to let your heart get involved.
Yes.
I've been fighting.
I have too.
I have too.
Work hard all of us. Here we go, further discussion, motion on the table. All those favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Close, like sign.
Aye. Close.
Same note, the motion carries for one. Anything that needs to come into the board for the office, appeal to you by close. Hearing nothing.
I'd like to point something out. There's been...
So close.
Well...
Yeah, go ahead.
I'd like to go on the record.
Sure.
In the union contract, specifically, Article 15, Section 11, this is not an ordinary situation. Recommendation goes to the county administrator. Your decision becomes a recommendation that takes arbitration. And that's exactly what we intend to do in this case. So I want to make sure the record's clear. This is not something that goes to the county administrator under the union contract. Anything to do so will be agreeable offense by the union, by Mr. Baughman. I'm not directing my comments to you. I'm just making the record that our next step in this process is not Mr. Vinny, but arbitration.
I don't think that's a matter for this
committee. I understand. I'm just making the record.
You stand adjourned. Thank you.